Christian.
No, sir. It's nothing. I don't feel my cheeriest after watching a man take a severe lashing.
Pass Mr. Young the potatoes, please. You've witnessed punishment before, surely? Go ahead. Speak your mind.
Well, sir, since you ask, it's the question of degree that troubles me. You see, if one flogs a man half to death for a minor infraction, then how does one punish him for a serious offense?
Minor infraction.
Robert F. Straub. Breaking that train window was a serious offense.
It was hot. I was thinking of my lungs.
Did you think about the possible consequences? You might have started a riot.
Even a convict's got a right to breathe.
Right? I don't think you know the meaning of the word.
In 1909 in Alaska, you appointed yourself judge, jury, and executioner and killed one Charles Donner because he allegedly beat up a friend named Katie Malone, a prostitute. Stroud, you were transferred here to Leavenworth because of an inferior record. Now, I propose to give you a fresh start. Such rights as you will enjoy are listed here in my rules and regulations. There are 86 of them. I suggest you memorize them.
I know them. They're the same in all pens. They tell you when to eat, when to sleep, when to go to the privy.
Precisely. And what you'll do for every minute, 24 hours a day.
But we could leave this place, perhaps. Yes, there's nothing to keep us here. We haven't any obligations here. We don't owe rent to anybody. We can just pack up our bags. Tonight, we could go now. I could take you for a wonderful trip around the country.
You can't leave here.
Why not?
Well, you've got to work. What about your job?
My job, that doesn't mean anything. I can always publish articles. My book's going to be published quite soon. It's a wonderful idea.
Well, I have to go to school. What about my education?
Your education? What sort of an education do you think you're getting here? You got a much better education when you're traveling around with me.
Well, look, the play has two more performances next week.
Oh, don't start talking about the play to me. That's what's just come between us. That's what started this whole row. Look, don't you want to get back to where we were before we came to this horrible place? Don't you want to come away with me?
No! I hate you!
You want to stay with this filthy boy? That's what it
is. Yes! Why don't you leave
me alone? Shut your mouth, you heartless little psychopath!
No, you're
I promise you one thing.
Grand.
You're not going to see these filthy boys anymore, I tell you that. That's one thing.
Oh, yeah, well, I've got news for you. I'm going to do anything I want to, anytime
shut
I
up,
want to, with anybody
shut
I want
mouth.
To. And you can't stop
shut
me.
Marion.
There were bells on the hill, but I never heard them ringing. No, I never heard them at all, till there was you.
It's been decided that you will be dressed as a priest. Help you get away in the pandemonium afterwards. Chun Jin will give you a two-piece Soviet Army sniper's rifle that fits nicely into a special bag. There's a spotlight booth that won't be in use. It's up under the roof on the 8th Avenue side of the garden. You will have absolutely clear, protected shooting. You are to shoot the presidential nominee through the head. And Johnny will rise gallantly to his feet and lift Ben Arthur's body in his arms, stand in front of the microphones and begin to speak. The speech is short, but it's the most rousing speech I've ever read. It's been worked on here and in Russia on and off for over 8 years. I shall force someone to take the body away from him. Then Johnny will really hit those microphones and those cameras with blood all over him, fighting off anyone who tries to help him, defending America even if it means his own death, rallying a nation of television viewers into hysteria to sweep us up into the White House with powers that will make martial law seem like anarchy.
World domination, same old dream. Our asylums are full of people who think they're Napoleon or God. You persist in trying to provoke me, Mr. Bond. I could have had you killed in the swamp. And why didn't you? I thought you less stupid. Usually when a man gets in my way... But you were different. You cost me time, money, effort. You damaged my organization and my pride. I was curious to see what kind of a man you were. I thought there might even be a place for you with Spectre. And I'm flattered. I prefer the revenge department. Of course, my first job would be finding the man who killed Strangways and Quarrel. Unfortunately, I misjudged you. You are just a stupid policeman. His luck is...
represents a ship. You got battle wagons, cruisers, destroyers, minesweepers, you got assault craft of every size and every type. It's the biggest amount of the world's ever known. Here. You remember it. You remember every bit of it.
Pardon, monsieur. Voudriez-vous me donner du feu, s'il vous plaît? Merci, monsieur.
Catherine était contente du succès de sa ruse. Jim et Jules étaient émus comme par un symbole qu'ils ne comprenaient pas.
Ou bien je rêve, ou alors il pleut.
C'est peut-être les deux. Alors, s'il pleut, partons au bord de la mer.
On part demain.
Oh, le terrain me paraît excellent. Je propose une course de vitesse. Au premier qui arrive au bout de la passerelle.
Attention, prêt. Un, deux, oh.
Thomas, vous avez triché.
Mais j'ai gagné.
Thomas gagne toujours. Il parle trois langues, nage comme un poisson.
Est-ce que Thomas sait faire les pieds au mur?
Vous lui apprendrez. Monsieur Jim, voulez-vous venir demain chez moi m'aider à porter mes bagages à la gare?